Morning.
Good morning.
Ask you, please stand as you're able to sing our first praise song to God, I Belong.
I see hope coming on the horizon. There's no need for hiding, 'cause I belong.
Somebody that was with us tested positive for COVID the next day, on Thursday. I feel fine, but it's been 4 days, and I'm just going to avoid you all today. So I stand here and wear my mask when I'm not speaking, for that very reason, just to be cautious. So that's the explanation for that. Hopefully my voice carries that extra 10 feet that it normally wouldn't have to carry. Please do fill out your attendance cards. We'll collect those during our time of offering. It's just a joy to be with you all here this morning. What a beautiful day. And, you know, this is the day the Lord has made. So let us all rejoice and be glad. Please join me, if you will, in prayer of the day. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. God of heaven and earth, before the foundation of the universe, at the beginning of time, you are the triune God.
Author of creation, eternal word of salvation, life giving spirit of wisdom, guide us from all truth by your spirit, that we may proclaim all that Christ has revealed, and rejoice in the glory he shares with us.
Glory and praise to you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 16th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
A little while, and you will no longer see me. And again, a little while, and you will see me. I'm sorry. I'm reading verse 16. Want to go back?
Sure.
Start over. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth. For he will not speak on his own, but will speak whatever he hears, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me, because he will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that the Father has is mine. For this reason, I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. It seems weird to stand up here. You all seem so short. Well, it's Holy Trinity Sunday. The Sunday that always falls after the Sunday of Pentecost. And it is the Sunday where I get to explain to you in great detail everything you need to know about the Holy Trinity, right? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, because it's super understandable. And if I can't help you understand how there could be three in one and one in three, then seminary people have completely failed. Because it's super easy to understand, right? Father, Son, Holy Spirit, not three separate entities, but one, not three different expressions of the same one, but three in one. It's bad math, so it doesn't work. And the readings that were selected for today, at least, the gospel lesson gives us an idea of the hint of the Holy Trinity as given to us in Scripture and through the teachings of Jesus. The word Trinity is not printed anywhere or written anywhere in Scripture, not in the Old or the New Testament, because it wasn't really a thing until Jesus' time, when he talked about the Spirit. And then it took, still taking thousands of years for us to try to figure this out. I have volumes of books in my office on my shelves trying to explain and help people to understand or help us to compartmentalize this idea of the Holy Spirit. And there's been all kinds of different metaphors used to try to explain, like imagine doing a children's sermon, trying to explain Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The most common one is usually some expression of water. We have steam, we have ice, and we have water. But the three of them don't exist all at the same time. You're one or the other. You don't have a steamy ice water bath thing that exists because they don't exist together. And it's just some kind of futile effort to help us to understand that. We can't figure it out. And we never will be able to figure out because it's not possible. It's a God thing. And there are many of those things that we don't understand, that we try to understand. We try to compartmentalize. We try to wrap our heads around. And in some ways, I think that's just part of the brokenness in us. There's an arrogance, defiance of God, which is the origin of sin. If we know God well enough and we can figure God out, then where does that put us? It puts us on the same level as God. It's just our nature to want to be in that space, which is why I have volumes of books in my office trying to explain all these things that are unexplainable. It goes along with communion. Do you all understand how it is that when I speak those words of institution, that the bread becomes bread and literally, physically, Jesus' body? And the grape juice or wine, when I speak those words, is literally transformed into Jesus' blood and still yet wine or grape juice. Does any of that make sense? Does the idea that Jesus was fully man and fully God make any sense? Man, does it make any sense at all that God is eternal? That God didn't have a beginning or an end? For you folks with younger children, or at one point when your children were young, did they ever ask you, how can God have never, how is it that God always existed? Something had to create in order for something to exist, right? Good luck trying to explain that one. That's the response to that one is usually, go ask the pastor. He'll explain it. There are lots and lots of things that we don't understand. And that's okay. And I've said that many times before. It is okay. Because trying to understand and figure out God is a futile effort. And I don't want to be able to understand and know God. But again, we're not comfortable with the gray areas of our world or our life. And we ask why questions all the time. Because if there's somehow there's an explanation that makes sense to us, we're like, oh, okay, I totally get that. And, I mean, we figured out a lot of stuff as human beings. But there are some things that we will never figure out. And we just have to be okay with that. That's got to be okay. And that's where faith fills in those gaps for us when we lack the understanding to be able to figure out the things of God. Quite often in our Bible studies, I get asked questions about, I don't understand this. How could God do this? Or why is this happening? Or some kind of why question that the answer quite often is, I don't know. Because it's not explainable. And it's in those instances that, again, our faith fills in those gaps, but also the things that we do also know about God. God is gracious in the ways that God has revealed himself to us. The scriptures, from beginning to end, bless you. That's a special blessing you see in church. You might think of scripture as a book of history. You might think of scripture as a book about a group of people or religion or about theology or about the things of God. That's not really, I mean, that's sort of, those parts are in scripture, but that's not really what it's about. From beginning to end, it's about God's revelation. It's about God revealing himself to creation, specifically to humankind, in the interactions between God and humankind. And for what purpose? Why does God need to reveal himself to us? To make himself known, right? Throughout the Old Testament, there is a phrase that gets repeated over and over again where God says something along the lines of, I'm going to do this so that people will know that I am God. And not just any God, but the holy and righteous God, Yahweh. The name that shouldn't be spoken because it doesn't capture the fullness of who God is. And in a world that existed back in those days, from the beginning of time, when people everywhere worshipped something, or many things to be more exact, they worshipped everything to answer those why questions. Like, why didn't it rain as much this year as it did last year? Why did something bad happen to me? Why did something good happen to my neighbor that I don't like very much? I'm a better person than they are. Good things shouldn't happen to them. Why does the sun come up in the same spot every day and set in the same spot? Storms and seas and oceans and all of those things that we have questions about, those why questions, were answered by saying, well, there must be a divine power. There must be something greater than us behind all of it. Because it just seems absurd that all of these things that happen in our world and could just be completely random and accidental. That it's just things are just happening because billions of years ago, some single cell organism was in this pool of water and eventually we walked out of it. That makes a lot of sense, right? There has to be explanations for things. So people worshiped everything. And they worshiped things that they knew. So they worshiped animals and trees and birds and all kinds of different things. To explain the whys. And so God from the beginning says, no. I'm the one. That's what the creation story is all about. I created everything. From the heavens and the earth, and the things that you can see, and the things that you can't see, to the single-celled microscopic organisms, to the planets and the solar systems and the universes. I created all of it and am sovereign and in control over all of it. And I'm going to reveal that to you in a number of ways. But I'm going to allow a group of people to be ones to witness to that, to share that news with other people. Because God is compassionate and God loves us. These are the things that we know to be true about God. God doesn't do it because God needs to do it. God never acts out of need. God is not lacking in anything. And when I say God, of course, it's Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. God only acts out of want, out of desire, out of God's nature to reveal God to us. And for the entirety of the Old Testament, God was terrifying. That's the God, the Father. In thunder and lightning, in presence, in the enormity of God, the awesomeness of God, earth opening up, seas being parted, you name it. When God revealed himself to the people, they generally shivered and fell to the ground because it was terrifying. But if you read the creation story, there was God the Spirit and God the Son there at the beginning, though they didn't quite understand all of that. There were these expressions, this difference. It's not really, I can't explain it, but there came a time when God said, I'm going to reveal myself to humankind in a different way, in a way that perhaps they can understand, to help them answer some of those why questions, to answer some of those questions that people have been asking themselves since the dawn of time. Who are we? Who is this creator? What does this all mean? Is there purpose in our lives? Is there purpose in our suffering? Does it have value, or do we just randomly exist as biological organisms that at one point are birthed and at one point die and return to the earth? Is there meaning in any or all of it? And if there is, what are we supposed to do? How are we supposed to live and act? So Christ is born and lives among us to help us to understand better some of those questions. Not to fully understand them, but to know the how we're supposed to live kinds of questions. To see in human form in a way that's much more relatable to us, what is God really like? And that's absolutely what Jesus did as he lived on this earth, as he showed us in human form, while fully being God still, what is it? What does God want? How would God act in this situation? Didn't give us all the details. Because we need that grace space. We need that uncertainty. Those things that we can't figure out because he was still fully God. We didn't get all of it. We got a lot of it. And Jesus sometimes boiled it down. And that John passage, that part of it I didn't read, was Jesus was talking about, there's things you're not going to understand. I'm going to send the Spirit. And then he starts speaking plainly, and the disciples are like, wow, now you're actually telling us like plainly things that we need to understand. There weren't a lot of those moments. But he boiled it down a lot of times for us, and we still overcomplicate it by, like, what are the greatest commandments? Love God and love your neighbor. And so in every situation, whenever we act or do something, we could ask ourselves that question, is this loving God, and is this loving my neighbor? And if we allow that grace space and that uncertainty, we can probably do a better job of loving our neighbor and loving God because there's no boundaries, there's no limits. The people that don't like the gray like rules. And they can justify themselves and their behaviors and attitudes and their actions by saying, well, I do that because I'm a Christian. I do that because that's the way God wants it. And when we do that, we bring ourselves up to an understanding everything that God is and does. That's not how it's supposed to work, at least in my opinion. So Jesus reveals to us a lot about who God is. Well, then he's not here anymore. So then God sends us the Holy Spirit. The Spirit that existed before the beginning of time. The Spirit that was the creative force in all of creation. The Spirit that fell on people in the Old Testament to allow them to do unbelievable, unexplainable things. The very power of God living in people. And that same spirit that raised Christ from the dead, that same spirit that existed in Jesus because it is Christ to heal, is that same power that lives and exists in us, so that the presence of God never leaves us or our person. The guiding force and spirit in you and I that sometimes can and will fill in those gaps for us in those gray areas of what we can and should do and how to live our lives and how to see the world and how to love God and love one another. It's that spirit that God gave to us. This day that we celebrate the Holy Trinity, not just one day of the year that we should celebrate that, but it is absolutely, not surprisingly, really amazing that God exists in that form. Because if it was just God the scary, intimidating God the Father, what would our lives be like? We'd kind of be terrified a lot, wouldn't we? You'd all show up at church more regularly, I guarantee that. And our offering plates would probably be overflowing. And you'd show up to everything we needed to do because you'd be afraid that on your way home or at home, the earth would open up and swallow you because God was angry. If it was just Jesus, then we'd have that sort of friendly, brotherly relationship. But perhaps it would be too much like us. And we would think of ourselves too much like Jesus because, well, he was just like us. He lived and he breathed and he bled and he cried and he ate and he did all those things that you shouldn't talk about in church. Most of them, at least. It wouldn't quite be the full picture of who God is. And then in the absence of the Son, we have the Holy Spirit to lead and guide us. Perhaps the most confusing of all of the three in one, one in three, this Holy Ghost, this Spirit that lives in us and with us and guides us and leads us and saves us and gives us faith and all of the things that we talk about that we don't understand, but praise be to God that he gave us the Spirit so that we do have faith, so that we don't have to know everything, so that we can come in humble adoration to worship and love God and love people, because that's what he wants from us. That's what God asks of us. That's what God deserves from us. Not to try to be like God. Not to figure out God. Not to know everything there is to know about God or be able to explain everything that can be explained about God. Who can do that? It can't be done. But in perfect form and harmony, in these three and one and one and three that I don't understand and can't figure out, it is the perfect balance, the perfect expression, the perfect revelation to us of who God is and who we are. More importantly, I forgot that part. I mean, Jesus dying on the cross, remember that? That was pretty awesome. That love that God has shown to us. It is absolutely magnificent. And maybe there's no measuring stick for it. It's not a what's better than the other, but it's just another example of God's amazing love and the way that God expressed and revealed himself to us in these different ways. It's like he knew what he was doing. Who would have thought? And instead of us, brothers and sisters, trying to step into that role and be the God or understand or control, put God in the box. Let God be God. Let God be who God is. So that we can be who God wants us to be. Please stand as you are able as we sing our song in response. Thank you. Almighty God, we offer you our praise for your awesomeness, God, for your perfection, for your compassion and your mercy. For all that you are, God, that we understand, and so much more than we don't understand. You alone are one. You alone are three. You alone are God and worthy of our praise. And we thank you, God. We thank you for the many ways in which you reveal yourself to us and the love that you have for us. To know that we are chosen, that we are loved, that we are redeemed, and reminded that in your eyes we are perfect. God of grace,
hear our prayers.
Because of your care and compassion, because, God, you only act out of desire to express yourself in ways that we can't even count, we come to you with our prayers of intercession, trusting in your mercy, God, trusting that you are acting in the midst of every situation, but particularly in those where we or our friends or the people on our prayer list find ourselves experiencing the trials that this life brings. We pray for healing. We pray for hope. We pray for peace and strength for everybody and anybody who has need, God. We pray especially for those that we now name to you in our hearts. God of grace,
hear our prayers.
We thank you that you allow us to be your witnesses, God, that you allow us to live a life that reflects your glory, to share in the glory that you possess, not because it's natural for us, but because you give it to us via your Spirit. Help and guide us, God, that we can be more powerful and noticeable witness to this world, to overcome, to be louder than the brokenness and the hatred and the divisiveness that is way too much a part of this world. For our voices to be louder, and for you to become known throughout the world as it is your desire. God of grace. And for those unspoken prayers and the things that are too hard even sometimes for us to think about, whatever they are, God, you're more than aware of them. And you're willing to share it in our burdens. So we lay those things at your feet, God, hoping that the peace and joy and strength that you promise us will come to us as you have. God of grace,
hear our prayers.
These and other prayers, God, we lift up to you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, again, trusting in your mercy. Amen.
Amen.
Peace of Christ be with you all.
Also with you.
Please share God's peace with one another. I'd like you to stand and join me as we pray over our offering. Let us pray.
Blessed are you, O God, maker of all things. Through your goodness you have blessed us with these gifts, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Use us in what we have gathered, in feeding the world with your love, through the one who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
In the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he gathered with his disciples. He took a loaf of bread, he gave thanks, and he broke it. He gave it to them to eat, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the meal had ended, Jesus took a cup of wine. He gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this also in remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let's pray the prayer our Lord taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
You may be seated. The gift of God for you, the people of God.
Thank you.
the body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you forever in his grace. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. So for announcements today, we had our Synod Assembly yesterday. I attended it online because I could, and that was a good thing because I heard there was no coffee at the assembly. So then actually, the city council afterwards decided, since it was a Lutheran event and there was no coffee, none of it counted. So they're rescheduling it for a time when there will be coffee. Third sacrament. This was the first time I tried to do it in one day, and I think probably in hindsight, they might think that it was probably too much to try to accomplish in one day. It went about 45 minutes longer than they had scheduled it to go. And there were still items that were on the agenda that didn't get voted on or discussed because they were already 45 minutes late. So not much that was earth-shattering that took place. There was quite a number of resolutions or memoriams. So a resolution is something that our synod adopts singularly, like this becomes a policy for us. A memoriam is something that gets sent to the church-wide for them to vote on whether it becomes a church-wide thing. And they mostly have to do with things like we need to be more equitable in our hiring practices. We need to provide for clergy or ordained people. Should there ever be a situation where someone isn't being asked to sign a non-disclosure agreement, if you know what that is, that the synod would provide legal counsel for the person that's being asked to sign that. Stuff like that, changing the language in some of our liturgy and some of our things that we publish, those are the kinds of things that we do for memoriams and resolutions. And they overwhelmingly get voted in favor of because you would come across as a terribly bad and mean person if you said, no, I didn't want to do that. It's like voting on clean water for everybody. So, nothing quite earth-shattering, but it was, for me, it's always more about, it's the fuller expression of our church. It's the body of Christ coming together in unity and making decisions. We don't have very many of those things that take place over the course of a church or a calendar year. So it is the expression of the ELCA and our little part of it. So that has great value to me, which is why I attend, which is why I was very grateful to attend online, because I could just walk away. But I can make lunch or breakfast or whatever and just listen to it. So, if you're all, anybody's interested in being a part of it next year, we'll make sure there's coffee. And if there's an online option. Other than that, the birthday anniversary list is in the back still, or again in the narthex for any corrections, additions, subtractions. I noticed there's a few of you that wrote in there, but your penmanship isn't spectacular. Really, really small, like to try to fit it in between other names. If you could go back and look again and see, or ask someone who's not you, can you read this? Then if they go, no, write it bigger, or write it on the back, or something. It doesn't have to be in that space where you want it to go. Because, you know, it's like deciphering hieroglyphics. So just double check that for the sake of clarity so we don't have to ask those questions of, what is this? Other than that, that's it. Any other? Brenda House, yeah, go ahead.
Well, I wasn't here last week, so I don't know if Pastor announced this or not, but I hope everybody noticed that the dead bushes are gone on the edge of the market out there. They were removed as one of our first acts of the facilities renewal fund. Another one coming up soon is new benches for the patio. They're supposed to be here maybe tomorrow. They told me 4 or 5 weeks. I'm like, wait, it hasn't even been 2. So I guess people are getting back to work. But that's the second thing we decided to do. And so I just wanted to... also, we call it the Norfam Farm because my husband tons of fruit trees in our front yard. And so I picked plums yesterday, Santa Rosa plums. Please keep them because I still have like 3 or 4 more pickings. So they're out there too. Thank you.
Thanks for helping. What's up, dude? You feel perfectly at home.
He's picked up right where Jackson and Carter left.
I know. He's an answer to that question.
Have a seat, John.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and in all things fill you with his peace. In the name of the Father, and Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.